Hello friends, in previous videos we have studied the three steam cycles, that is Rankine cycle, Carnot cycle and reheat cycle. In this video we are going to study another cycle, that is called as regenerative cycle. So let us do the analysis of regenerative cycle. So first of all let us study what is regeneration. Now in order to increase the mean temperature of the heat in addition to TM1 and to reduce the external thermal irreversibility, it is needed to provide the attention on the increasing amount of heat which is supplied at the temperature. This is very high value, such as first is increasing the superheat, second using the high pressure of the steam, third using the temperature of the steam, then using reheat. So by using all these processes, the temperature can be increased. Now the mean temperature of the heat addition can also be increased by reducing the amount of heat which is added at the low temperature in the economizer section of the steam generator. Here attention is focused in the process of heat transfer between the flue gases and the feed water. So the flue gases which are released, they are also at the high temperature. So this temperature can also be utilized. This irreversibility could be entirely eliminated if the feed water could be entered into the steam generator at a saturated liquid state 5 rather than 4. Now this is possible by the process of the regeneration, in which energy is exchanged internally between the expanding fluid in the turbine and the compressed fluid before the heat addition. So this process is called as regeneration. Now let us study the Stirling cycle. Now a well-known gas cycle that uses the regeneration method is the Stirling cycle. It comprises of two reversible isotherms and two reversible isochores. Now heat addition at the constant temperature T1 from an external source and the heat rejection at a constant temperature T2 to an external sink takes place in the process 4-1 and 2-3 respectively. So the regeneration or the heat exchange occurs reversibly between 1-2 and 3-4 as shown in figure. So here the figure shows regenerative Stirling cycle with the reversible heat transfer between the process 1-2 and 3-4. So if we see here, it is a graph which shows the T2S. Then here between 1-2 and 3-4, there is a transfer of heat. Now the area under 1-2 and 3-4 denoting the heat loss by the expanding fluid gained by the compressed fuel is equal. Therefore, all the heat can be added reversibly at T1 and all the heat is rejected reversibly at T2. So the ideal Stirling cycle has the same efficiency as the Carnot cycle. Now let us study the ideal regenerative cycle. Now following the Stirling cycle, in the regenerative cycle, as shown in figure A, the condensate after leaving the pump circulates around the turbine casing. As a result of this, heat is transferred from the vapor expanding in the turbine to the condensate which is circulating around it. Also, it is assumed that this heat transfer process is reversible, that is, at each point the temperature of the vapor is only infinitesimally higher than the temperature of the liquid. So the process 1-2 thus represents the reversible expansion of the steam in the turbine with reversible heat injection to the surrounding liquid, which is heated reversibly by the process 4S and 5. So here the figure shows ideal regenerative cycle in which the heat can be again utilized to generate the steam. Now if we consider for a small step, So we can write delta T water is equal to minus delta T steam. Similarly, delta S water is equal to minus delta S steam. So here T is temperature, whereas S is entropy. Now the slope of the lines 1, 2 and 5-4S in figure A are thus identical in contour. Now the areas are not only equal but also congruous. Therefore, all the heat which is added from an external source, that is Q1, is at the constant temperature T1, and all the heat which is rejected Q2 is at the constant temperature T2, and both are reversible. Then we can write Q1 is equal to H1 minus H5 is equal to T1 bracket S1 minus S5. Similarly, Q2 is equal to H2 minus H3 is equal to T2 bracket S2 minus S3. Since the reversible heat transfer, we can write delta S UNI is equal to delta S water plus delta S steam is equal to 0. Similarly, therefore delta S water is equal to minus delta S steam. This can also be written as S5 minus S3 is equal to S1 minus S2, which can again rearranged as S1 minus S5 is equal to S2 minus S3. So the efficiency can be calculated as efficiency is equal to 1 minus Q2 divided by Q1, which is also equal to 1 minus T2 divided by T1. So we can say that the efficiency of the ideal regenerative cycle is like the Stirling cycle, which is equal to the Carnot cycle. Hence, if we write the steady flow energy equation for the turbine, we get HT minus WT minus H2 plus H4S minus H5 is equal to 0. Which can be further modified as WT is equal to bracket H1 minus H2 minus bracket H5 minus H4S. Further, it can be simplified as but the pump work in case of regenerative cycle will remain same as in case of Rankine cycle. Hence, WP is equal to H4S minus H3. Thus, we can say that the net output of work of the ideal regenerative cycle is thus less, and hence its steam rate will be more, although it is more efficient as compared to the Rankine cycle. However, this cycle is not practicable because first, reversible heat transfer cannot be realized in a finite time. Then, the heat exchanger in the turbine is mechanically impracticable. Also, the moisture content of the steam in the turbine is high, which will lead to the excessive erosion of the turbine blades. So, because of these facts, the regenerative cycle is not practically possible. So, in this way, we have studied the analysis of regenerative cycle. Thank you friends for watching this video. Stay tuned with Ekeeda and do subscribe our channel Ekeeda. Thank you.